The mystery flesh pit. I know that sounds dirty. I promise it's not. It's a living cave believed to be the internal organs of a leviathan creature extending more than 19,000 feet into the earth. So gargantuan that a plethora of otherworldly creatures make up a complex eat or be eaten ecosystem inside of its bowels. The only thing more colossal are the memories that you and your loved ones will make on your vacation to the mystery flesh pit National Park, a Lovecraftian vista that's safe and fun for the whole family. God damn it. The Mystery Flesh Pit National Park is a now defunct national park in Texas. We know about this park because of one artist, Trevor Roberts, aka Strange Vehicles on Reddit, who has an extensive collection of media and artifacts relating to the park. They've done a great job documenting it, and I'll be linking to their work in the description. The cave was first reported in a letter from an employee of an oil company to one Colton Fleming on May 2nd, 1973. To better understand the gravity of this discovery, I'm going to read a section from this letter. This thing that those old boys found is some kind of organic deposit that must go down at least 500 or 600 feet by my reckoning. Not a fungus either. This thing breathes and makes sounds same as any other creature. And it bleeds. God, how it bleeds. Soon after its discovery, a deep earth mining pit by the name of Anodyne stepped in and began managing the flesh pit. Anodyne was responsible for creating and maintaining, and I use that second word very loosely, the infrastructure around and inside the mystery flesh pit. They got it sanctified as a national park, meaning it is preserved by the government but can still be used by companies independently. Since Anodyne maintained access to the resources, they had the genius idea of mining through the creature's internal organs and tissues for the strange materials inside. Anodyne used these never-before-seen biological materials in a strange myriad of new products. For example, a computer that processes information using a neural tissue from the creature. The profits and expansion turned this mining company into a multi-industry conglomerate mega-company. The local populace tried to capitalize on it as well, and the town identity shaped around the pit, like Roswell in UFO culture. But not everyone was in love with the pit. This thing was hard to sell at first.
Okay, so we have a giant sarlacc pit in the middle of Texas, and we want people to willingly climb down its throat. But how do we market it?
Hypnotize the children?
Get out of my head.
Enter Caver Coop. Caver Coop was a fictional character that starred in animated children's propaganda films to make people not afraid of the cave. This character became so popular that they created Caver Coop's Spooky Halloween Carnival, with fun children's activities such as haunted hayrides, scary petting zoo signed liability waiver required, and blood! In the belly of the beast lies an ecology that blurs the line between what is ecosystem and what is immune system. The majority, if not all, of the fauna is blind because before humanity lit the inside of this creature's body, it was in complete darkness. Meet the Abyssal Copepod, a crustacean-like creature that can grow up to 20 feet or 6 meters long. The copepod has a varied diet, including humans. Many accidents in the park involve these misunderstood beasts and overeager tourists. They also got these weird little grabby fingers. If you look around a bit, you're certain to find macrobacteria sliding across the fleshscape. These massive 12-foot bacterial blobs are unlike anything else seen on the surface, macrocosms of the single-celled life we frequently encounter but never see. Equally as strange, the Amorphous Shame looks like a pile of loose organs with no rhyme or reason. It's actually theorized to be the ancient descendant of a weasel that crawled into the cave. All of its body parts became vestigial and shriveled away over time, and now it's just a pile of fleshy bits that squeezes throughout the folds of the organism, absorbing nutrients in a fashion similar to osmosis. A rare encounter. A lone gasp owl stares blankly into the distance and sounds its mating call. These are just the tip of the iceberg, as there are many more elusive oddities such as the shrieking cloistropod, stinging triocanth, gastric bristleworm, and the Venus shamble. Keep an eye out for them. I mean, as long as you've signed your waivers, I don't really care, but you're probably gonna want to anyway. Now that you've signed your liability waivers, it's time to have some fun. But before we get going, here are some state-mandated safety tips that we've developed from good old-fashioned trial and error. Remember to stay a safe distance away from creatures in the pit. If it changes its behavior because of you, looks at you, raises its antennae, secretes scent enzymes, or begins making territorial clicks while trying to locate you, you are too close. us. Allow all organisms to continue unhindered, and you may just be afforded the opportunity to safely observe these amazing creatures in their natural habitat. It's always important to be aware of your surroundings to avoid hazards. Remember, you're in the internal systems of a living organism, and this environment is actively hostile towards human life. This calcified multicolored formation is known as the Circus Clown Chymus, a beautiful yet dark reminder of why you should always stay on the trail. A group of performing clowns fell into the upper maw of the entry orifice, and a dilation of an epiglottal fold allowed them to slide into a then unreinforced area of the pit. Rescue personnel were able to locate them in a digestive sac, but they had already been heavily digested. Many of them were still alive, but they fused together as their giblets melted and now existed as one large, runny, writhing mass. An experimental antacid was applied to the gooey, screaming mound, but it was too late. The compound flash calcified the mass to the hauntingly stunning formation you see in front of you. While this is brutal, it's still not the worst case scenario of what can happen in the pit. I mean, could you imagine what could have happened if these performers didn't sign waivers? On rare occasions, creatures from the megafauna's body will venture out onto the surface and drag animals back down into the pit. In the uncommon instance that they aren't immediately consumed, they can undergo strange phenomena known as anatomical amalgamation that we are proud to say happens nowhere else on the planet. This process results in a compound organism, which is a hybrid of different surface animals. This process is not fully understood, but we do know that it often results in partial fusion of major body elements and sometimes the relocation of internal organs to the outside of the body. Should you encounter one, please don't feed it or engage in any other activities that could prolong its suffering. In the unlikely event that you find a compound organism containing one or more human beings, please contact the park staff, and you'll be entered in a raffle to receive a complimentary Flesh Pit t-shirt or hat.
Have you or a loved one been combined with one or more whitetail bucks while visiting the pulsating vistas of the Mystery Flesh Pit National Park? All new from Anodyne, it's the Brain Case. Now your brain, and if you're lucky, spinal cord can exist in the new streamlined state-of-the-art fishbowl life support system. If you purchase the premium package, you could even get a vocoder to communicate and some of your sense organs back to deliver a sensory experience close to which of that you previously enjoyed. All for one low price of $99.99.
Your journey into the flesh pit will begin as you descend an elevator deep into the beast and arrive at the lower visitor center. This expansive multi-story shopping complex has everything. Restaurants, clothing stores, romantic depots, the whole nine yards. Some of the restaurants were accused of serving the meat from the walls of the cave, but it was denied by the park. People have tried the meat, though, and confirmed that it was too gamey to market to even the most adventurous of eaters. However, the arthropod monsters running around are reportedly delectable when steamed with a side of butter. I'm guessing they taste like somewhere between lobster and crab. Experience the majesty of nature from the inside on one of our many hikes. For a breath of fresh air, try visiting the Northern Bronchial Forest. On the Swallowed Hole Tour, you experience a vorophile's dream in reverse and climb up an 8-story esophagus. Be careful, this one is marked for those who don't have a fear of being eaten alive. For the refined consumer, consider visiting the Intrapark Wellness Resort in the stomach, overlooking the beautiful gastric seas. This isn't just a family park, if you know what I mean. If you're looking for a romantic getaway, the Amniotic Fluid Springs are the perfect place to put the spark back in any relationship. The fluid is an aphrodisiac, has healing properties, and guests sometimes report making life-lasting emotional connections in the pit. The springs range in dilution. The higher the dilution, the stronger the effects. If you are visiting a spa below the green line, please consult a physician beforehand. If you are visiting a spa below the yellow line, please consult a religious figure or sexual wellness counselor beforehand. The areas with lower concentration are open to all ages, but after a few people caught cases from the FBI, we decided to restrict the springs in the pit with the highest concentrations to 18 years of age or older. You may have come across this amniotic fluid before you even stepped foot in the park. This juice has led to an effective treatment for Alzheimer's, cancers, and many other life-threatening illnesses. Anodyne also provides it to companies to create consumer goods like Coke Heartthrob, the feel-good McFlurry, and our proprietary aphrodisiac liqueur. So you're probably wondering why this place got shut down. Let me read the entire incidents report from July 4th, 2007, because I'm legally obligated to. Incident timeline. Start of relevant timeline. 10:29 a.m. July 4th. Unseasonably high rains force park administration to cancel a July 4th concert and fireworks display scheduled to take place on the surface park grounds. Many visitors who had already purchased tickets to the event become upset, and a decision is made to extend the park hours until midnight for those who had purchased event tickets. 8 p.m. Normal closing time for National Park. A typical shift change of reduced night staff in the control room takes place. 9:16 p.m. Harvesting crews working in the western extremities of the organism set a new extraction record to meet a quota for bonuses in time for the holiday weekend. 9:30 p.m. Control room operators initiate a routine system self-test and discover a relay fault error resulting from increased electrical demand from mining equipment and tourist infrastructure. A control room operator logs the fault and notifies an on-duty engineer. 9:41 p.m. July 4th. Water drainage from surface rain into entry orifice begins to collect in the sand gullet. Drainage pumps are automatically activated by a sensor system but fail to initialize due to relay fault. An emergency backup pump running on a separate emergency circuit is automatically activated. 9:42 p.m. A critical alarm in the control room alerts operators that the emergency water pump has seized and is inoperative. Under-lubrication of the pump's implier bushings resulted in corrosion due to the moist interior of the flesh pit environment. 9:48 p.m. Technicians arrive at the primary pump station to discover the sand gullet almost completely submerged. Water begins to pour over the dorsal respiratory ridge and into the bronchial bulbules. Control room operators divert power to hydraulic stent ramps to brace for expected choke response. 9:51 p.m. Technicians repair a relay fault as the control staff resets the park electrical grid. The grid is offline for 45 seconds. The automatic PA system does not notify guests as the system is scheduled to automatically shut down at the normal 8 p.m. closing time. The temporary lapse of lighting causes many guests to become panicked and return to the main gantry lift at the lower visitor center. 9:52 p.m. A choking action from the organism begins 31 seconds into the electrical reset. The main dorsal trunk violently flexes. Lack of power to the hydraulic arming rams causes irreparable damage to several sections of internal infrastructure. 9:53 p.m. As the electrical system finishes the reboot cycle, the dynamic hydraulic actuators supporting the lower visitor center overcorrect for stability, not accounting for the shift in the wall lining of the nexial cavity in which the visitor center facility is anchored. Two of the six structural supports are torn from their foundations, which causes the facility to list 20 degrees off vertical. The base joint of the vertical entry gantry is bent beyond its design limit angle. 9:54 p.m. The master alarm is tripped automatically. Surface facilities are notified as response teams are given the order to mobilize. 9:56 p.m. Park rangers are dispatched to rescue groups of visitors trapped in partially collapsed tunnels and trails. 10:03 p.m. Continued movement of the organism combined with rainwater causes one of the upper entry gantry supports to slip. An outbound elevator conducts an emergency stop, stranding over two dozen visitors. 10:05 p.m. Tremors registered as far away as the DFW Metroplex. 10:06 p.m. Soil liquefaction destabilizes surface facilities in and around the organism. Dilation anchors begin retracting to keep the entry orifice open. 10:12. A master failsafe is activated by the automatic park management system. 20,000 liters of acinetin compound are injected into the superorganism via a distributed network of relay stations located throughout its known internal anatomy. 10:12 p.m. Tremors and convulsions intensify as the entry gantry connection to the lower visitor center detaches completely. The lower visitor center begins to collapse downward into the nexial cavity. 10:12 p.m. Peristatic muscle action of the nexial cavity begins to exert substantial pressure on the outer structure of the lower visitor center facility. 10:15 p.m. The prime labioid junction just west of septum falls geobiological feature flexes into an open position, releasing a torrent of lastrogastric chyma into the dorsal trunk. It is likely that this was a reaction to the acinetin injection. 10:16 p.m. Peristatic spasms force the costa chyma slurry through the nexial cavity and up the lower and upper moisture crops towards the surface orifice. 10:16 p.m. Many guests attempting to flee the stalled elevator near the entry orifice attempt climbing out the upper moisture crop but are ultimately unsuccessful due to the torrential rains causing the surface to become very slippery. Many end up falling back into the maw. 10:17 p.m. The chyma slurry erupts from the surface orifice in a geyser several hundred meters in height. Large pieces of undigested organic matter crush several vehicles and damage windows. 10:19 p.m. Following the several-minute-long ejecta event, a deep and incredibly loud roar erupts from the entry orifice as ground tremors intensify further. Large extremities begin surfacing through bedrock and soil approximately 30 to 120 kilometers from the entry orifice. 10:25 p.m. The acrid smell of the gastric ejecta can be detected as far as Odessa, Texas. 10:26 p.m. Two Park Service vehicles and a tour vehicle containing Park Service employees and several guests attempt to ascend through the entry orifice tube. 10:27 7 p.m., peristatic action crushes one or more of the tour vehicles and sucks the other two vehicles back into the nexial cavity and down into a digestive organ. These vehicles are presumed destroyed. 10:58 p.m., the Pentagon is given authorization from the White House to use nuclear force if necessary to prevent the organism from entering a non-dormant state. 11:02 p.m., the on-site operations director within the lower visitor center control room initiates a final fail-safe measure in the form of redacted contingency measure. 11:02, master log event records successful spin-up of the redacted contingency measure. 11:05 p.m., lower visitor center structural integrity is critically compromised, resulting in total collapse. 11:05 p.m., data connection with lower visitor center is severed. 11:13 p.m., spasms and motor action of the superorganism begin to noticeably subside. Response teams begin to descend into the surface orifice to attempt rescue operations. 11:19 p.m., response team encounters visitor group which had attempted to escape from stalled elevator. Most are dead, the remainder are mortally wounded and partially digested due to gastric ejecta. 11:42 p.m., radio contact established with ranger vehicle trapped in Oyster Shame. Due to ventricle closure, no feasible rescue strategy can be developed before complete mastication occurs. 11:56 p.m., response team confirms that redacted contingency measure and associated facility are still intact and operating. 11:58 p.m., Texas Governor Rick Perry formally declares a state of emergency for Gumption County. 12:22 a.m., July 5th, response teams route data/power umbilical to new base camp in redacted contingency measure facility. 12:35 a.m., three interpit life forms are identified as having been ejected into the surface. 15 visitors are injured and 7 are hunted by the interpit life forms during panicked evacuation of surface resort. 12:41 a.m., park staff manage to kill the three large life forms. 1:02 a.m., National Guard helicopters begin delivering supplies and personnel to aid in site containment. 1:58 a.m., field hospital is constructed to care for wounded staff and visitors. 2:37 a.m., initial damage surveys report catastrophic destruction of internal park infrastructure. Hit geobiology has dramatically changed in hazard level. 3 a.m., emergency teleconference of Anodyne executive leadership. National Parks Director and Security of the Interior are present. 3:12 a.m., executive decision is made to initiate FEMA response and assemble a task force for containing superorganism. 4 a.m., media helicopters and vehicles begin to report on the scope of the disaster. 4:39 a.m., base camp technicians begin to spin down redacted contingency measure. Large fracture due to inertial stress have appeared on mineral components. Engineers advise against reinitializing redacted contingency measure until mineral components can be replaced or repaired. 6:08 a.m., ground personnel begin assembling a pump system to inject industrial sedative into the superorganism. Transport trucks containing industrial sedative arrive. 9:45 a.m., emergency teleconference of Anodyne shareholders. 11:20 a.m., several injured visitors inexplicably leave field hospital and begin walking towards the open pit orifice. Approximately 38 individuals are able to crawl back into the orifice over the course of 8 hours. None are recovered. 3:51 p.m., radio transmission from trapped ranger vehicle ceases. Many speculate that other small groups of visitors and staff are still trapped. End of relevant timeline. This incident is responsible for over 750 fatalities, 1,800 major injuries, and 18,000 people sought medical and psychological treatment for symptoms including chest pains, shortness of breath, nausea, birth defects, hallucinations, depression, anxiety, internal bleeding, sore throat, and headaches as a result of the gastric ejecta that was released into the atmosphere. The investigators have concluded that this disaster was caused by Anodyne's negligent practices, and because this was bound to happen with something that's literally a testament to man's hubris built inside of a giant monster. But it totally wasn't their fault at all, because stop asking questions and go home.